Commission on Human Rights.
A nombre de todos mis colegas y del personal de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos,
I wish to warmly welcome all of you here today, those of us joining us here in this historic UNAM building, the Palacio de Minería.
Deseo darles la más cordial bienvenida a todos ustedes, a aquellos que están con nosotros en este histórico edificio de la UNAM, el Palacio de Minería.
And those joining us through the webcast as well.
Así como aquellos que nos acompañan a través del webcast.
To this historic 152nd special session of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights in Mexico.
A esta histórica sesión especial número 52 de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos en México.
I wish to especially welcome the distinguished representatives of the state of Belize and also the representatives of civil society who are participating in this hearing.
Deseo especialmente darle la bienvenida a los distinguidos representantes del Estado de Belice y a la sociedad civil que participa en esta audiencia.
This hearing relates to the situation relating to human rights in Belize, and the webcast is being transmitted in English.
Esta audiencia se relaciona con la situación de derechos humanos que prevalece en Belice y el webcast se está transmitiendo en idioma inglés.
During this hearing, we will receive information on the situation of migrants and LGBTI persons.
Durante esta audiencia recibiremos información sobre la situación de las comunidades maya y otras.
Let me introduce you to my colleagues at the head table.
Permítanme presentarles a mis colegas en la mesa de honor.
The first Vice President, Commissioner Rosemary Antoine.
La primera vicepresidente, comisionada Rosemary Antoine.
The second vice president and former president and rapporteur for the rights of migrants, Felipe González.
El segundo vicepresidente y expresidente y relator de los derechos de los migrantes, Felipe González.
The former president, Jesús Orozco.
Expresidente Jesús Orozco.
The country rapporteur, Commissioner Rosa María Ortiz.
La comisionada de país, Rosa María Ortiz.
Commissioner Paolo Vannucchi.
Comisionado Pablo Vannucchi.
And Commissioner Jim Cavallaro.
Y el comisionado Jim Cavallaro.
I'm also accompanied by the Executive Secretary, Emilio Álvarez y Casa.
Me acompaña también el secretario ejecutivo, Emilio Álvarez y Casa.
And the Deputy Executive Secretary, Elizabeth Abi Merced.
Y la secretaria ejecutiva adjunta, Elizabeth Abi Merced.
The Commission highly values the opportunity provided by the State of Mexico to hold this special session outside of the headquarters of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights.
La Comisión valora enormemente la oportunidad que nos da el Gobierno de México para celebrar esta sesión especial fuera de la sede de la Comisión Interamericana de Derechos Humanos.
This gives the people of the Americas even more access to the human rights mechanisms of the Inter-American Human Rights System.
Esto le brinda a los pueblos de las Américas incluso mayor acceso a los mecanismos de derechos humanos del sistema interamericano de derechos humanos.
When we hold hearings outside of the Commission's headquarters,
cuando celebramos audiencias fuera de la sede de la Comisión,
the Commission generally focuses on the human rights situation in the region in which it is located.
La Comisión por lo general se centra en la situación de derechos humanos en la región en la que se sitúa.
But not that of the country in which the hearings are being held.
Pero no en la del país en la que se están celebrando las audiencias.
As a result, we will have 7 hearings.
Como resultado, celebraremos 7 audiencias.
That will be held over the next 3 days.
En los próximos 3 días.
And all relate to the human rights situation in Central America.
Todas ellas relacionadas con la situación de derechos humanos en las Américas.
Please join us at 10:45 a.m. for the hearing on the general situation in Costa Rica.
Por favor, acompáñenos a las 10:45 a.m. para la audiencia sobre la situación general en Costa Rica.
and at 12:30 p.m. for the general situation of human rights in El Salvador.
Y a las 12:30 para la situación general de derechos humanos en El Salvador.
All the other hearings, including those on Wednesday and Thursday, will be webcast in Spanish.
Todas las demás audiencias, incluyendo aquellas del miércoles y jueves, se transmitirán por webcast en español.
With those introductory remarks, I wish to invite the representatives of civil society to make their presentation.
Una vez dicho lo anterior, me gustaría invitar a los representantes de la sociedad civil
to make your presentations,
para que hagan sus presentaciones
and to begin by introducing yourselves to us all. Welcome.
Y que por favor empiecen presentándose ustedes mismos. Bienvenidos a todos.
Thank you so much. Good morning, honorable commissioners, state representative, members of civil society, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Araceli Peña, and I'm representing to Dependent Monitoring Group of El Salvador, GEMIAS, but it's acronym in Spanish. Next to me is Armando Cobo. He is representing the NGO Health for Progress in Belize. A project named Migrant Workers Exercise Their Labor Rights is being implemented in Costa Rica, El Salvador, and Belize. This experience has been successful to bring in for knowledge, highlighting the situation of migrant human rights. Our exposition will emphasize four aspects. The first one, good practices attributed to government of Belize in order to improve migrants' living conditions and right respect for them and their families. Second, some situations of discrimination of migrants and LGBTI population. Third, migrants having obstacles in exercising their labor union rights. And finally, we will bring to your attention the situation concerning the detention of irregular migrants in Belize and their alternatives. In accordance with the first point, good practices, some situations. The migration phenomenon has been around for a long time. Certain economic, social, and environmental circumstances can create an increase in the quantities of people who choose to migrate and insert themselves into the Belize society. Therefore, we recognize the appropriation that the state of Belize makes about its role as a destination country. Awareness and commitment with human rights protection is reflected in supporting informative and sensitizing campaigns about recognition of migrant labor rights. We recognize the work done by the migratory entities regarding the provisions of regularization procedures for victims of human trafficking, specifically on campaigning boys, girls, and teenagers who are seeking family reunification as they are migrating alone. Likewise, we congratulate the amnesties carried out to allow irregular migrants residing in Belize to qualify for regularizing their immigration status and thriving just and favorably conditions. We also recognize the openness to dialogue that the government of Belize has shown with Honduras, Guatemala, and El Salvador to address joint strategies that allow them to build safeguard for the rights of migrants from these Central America's countries. Mainly, we refer to the negotiation for the signing of bilateral agreements that facilitate the granting of temporary work permits for those migrants. Therefore, we urge the government of Belize to continue exercising this good practice that represents a shared benefit for Belize, the country of origin, and the migrants and their families. Similarly, we congratulate the participation that the government of Belize has shown in the regional dialogue spaces developed under the Central American Integration System Framework, SICA, but it's acronym in Spanish, during security issues with a focus on human rights and regional integration have been considered. We believe that Belize has proven to be a visionary country willing to carry out actions that lead to the achievement of this purpose. Now I give the word to my colleague of Belize. He's going to continue with the presentation.
Good morning, Honorable Commission. Everything previously described denotes the great advances that have been obtained in Belize. However, there are still situations that show great challenges to overcome in order to set an explicit recognition and provide comprehensive and effective human rights protection for migrants. The following expresses some situations denoting obstacles to the full exercise of certain rights: right to association and collective bargaining. Under the provisos of the American Convention on Human Rights, freedom to organize in labor unions and the right of association should be exercised as an unfettered right, through which the defense of legitimate interests of workers in general is exercised. Under such recognition, this right can only be restricted by situations of national security, public order, health, public morals, and the rights of freedom of others. The situation in Belize determines that according to its laws, anti-union discrimination is prohibited. However, we have determined that there are measures that hinder the exercise of this right. We sustain the statement in the categorization that includes the migrant population, which has prohibited union membership and hence their participation in the union's board. Agricultural production areas are traditionally economic areas where there are not only deplorable and inhumane working conditions, but systematically these areas violate the fundamental rights of workers, such as the right to organize, to strike, and to bargain collectively. The same applies to the export processing zones, EPZs, where any attempt at union organization is crushed by the dismissal of the workers who try to organize. In addition, migrant workers inserted into other career fields are subject to threats of dismissal or removal from the country by their employers when trying to make this right effective. Given these limitations, the right to organize is banned for all migrant workers, regardless of their immigration status. Human rights of the LGBTI population. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights gives us all the enjoyment of the right of life, liberty, security, etc. Thus, equality must be respected in all areas of life of a citizen. Under such recognition, we note that the sexual preference or conditions should not be reasons to establish distinction, much less discrimination or persecution. We have seen that in Belize situations occur that undermine the fundamental rights of LGBTI people, including A, the discrimination that employers exercise when offering work opportunities, who upon learning of the sexual preference of or status of persons require HIV tests, as well as tests to verify the non-existence of sexually transmitted diseases, in order to use these results as a justification for not hiring them. B, other scenarios of discrimination, but mostly of persecution, are the ones stated by the Belizean legislation when prohibiting entry to Belizean territory if the person declares his or her preference or if he or she is perceived as such, and also the penalty of 10 years imprisonment set to those who have sexual relations between persons of the same sex. Arrest of illegal migrants. Finally, we call attention to the fact that according to the implementation of the Immigration Act of Belize, anyone who enters Belizean territory illegally is deprived of liberty. We consider important to note that this legislation establishes a categorization called prohibited immigrant, which groups, among other things, persons who enter and stay in the country without having a visa, and that for this reason are subject to a fine and or a prison sentence of 6 to 8 months, and an extension of extra 4 months is very likely. This same categorization includes the LGBTI population and persons engaged in prostitution. Given this scenario, the signing organizations show an imminent concern regarding the criminalized treatment that raises an illegal migration status to the level of crime, and that violates the fundamental rights of migrants, some of them being freedom of movement, right to legal representation, right to a hearing, due process, among others. Likewise, we note the double violation to which the migrant is exposed, who after his or her request, her arrest, sorry, is confined in prison alongside those convicted for criminal offenses because overcrowding does not allow to meet the requirements by law, that is to place the illegal migrant in the area of people who are waiting sentence. Because of this, we advocate a humane treatment, not punitive treatment of migrants in an irregular status who are arrested in Belize. Furthermore, we report that some employers use such sanctions to threaten their migrant workers in an irregular status to report them to the proper authorities. In some cases, these threats transcend and materialize through the complaint. These practices have proven to be a mechanism to manipulate the working people to stop them from requiring their respective rights. And by so doing, employers can evade their responsibilities. With this in mind, we state that labor rights most violated by some employers were the enjoyment of holiday pay, overtime pay, working hours according to the law, and minimum wage. For all these reasons, the situations exposed contravene with rights expressed on the Articles 1.1, 2, 5, 6, 8, 16, 24, 25, and 26, all from the American Convention on Human Rights. Finally, we request the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights to urge the State of Belize, 1, to guarantee the exercise of the migrant workers' right to freedom of association through the monitoring of the free zones and other labor markets, which expressly recognize the right to labor union membership. After this action, we require the same state to promote respect for this right in light of the conventions of freedom of association and protection of the right to organize, Convention number 87 of the ILO, and the right to association and collective bargaining, Convention 98 of the ILO, that Belize has ratified, and to implement action plans to monitor, verify, and sanction anti-union practices in the workplace. 2, to promote a culture of respect for the LGBTI population. 3, to intensify the promotion of such culture and encourage respect for the human rights of this population group on fair and equitable terms, as well as to eradicate racism and other gender inequalities. 4, to carry out immigration law reform and to harmonize it according to the protection of rights, principles, and international law related to the subject. Because according to international standards, deprivation of liberty should be the last resort to take. In Belize, unfortunately, deprivation of liberty is the first and only step. We also demand that the state not use the systematic arrest of the migrant when such migrant is faced with the impossibility of paying the prescribed fine. And we encourage the use of alternative to detention. 5, we also want to encourage the state to establish a shelter for migrants with full respect of their human rights. 6, we also request that a comprehensive migration policy be put in place in order to eliminate all forms of migration discrimination. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much to the petitioners. I want to now again welcome the representatives of the state, the distinguished ambassador and his team, and to invite Mr. Ramsey to make his presentation and to introduce the delegation.
May it please the Commission, Madam President, honorable members of the Commission, distinguished members of civil society, our gracious hosts in this beautiful city, members of the public. It is indeed an honor to be present to reaffirm Belize's commitment to human rights for all persons. And I'd like to begin by thanking the members of civil society for their presentation. My name is Mark Ramsey. I'm a Crown Counsel in the Attorney General's Ministry of Belize. I am joined by Ms. Michelle Vanzi, Chargé d'Affaires, and Mr. Carlos Montero, First Secretary from the Embassy of Belize in Mexico City. This morning, I will address five main issues in the presentation. First, I'll give a general introduction on the situation of human rights in Belize. Then I will address the issue of Belize's commitment to treaty obligations. Third, Belize's steps towards social protection. Four, Belize's efforts in combating and addressing the issues with HIV/AIDS. And five, issue with migration and refugee workers. If it pleases the Commission. Belize has a long history of democracy free from civil unrest and human rights abuses. It was the last country within Central America and the last within CARICOM to attain its independence in 1981. In the 1980s, there was an influx of immigrants from Central America who fled civil unrest in the region. This immigration continues today, albeit at a lesser pace. The National Population and Housing Census of 2010 states that 15% of the Belizean population is foreign-born, with over 80% of these immigrants coming from Central America and Mexico. Belize's population increased by 30.2% in the decade between the year 2000 and 2010, from 240,204 to 312,698. After extensive national consultations, the government of Belize developed in 2010 its long-term national development framework called Horizon 2030. This framework establishes a set of long-term goals, targets, and indicators to guide concerted action by all stakeholders involved in the development, implementation, monitoring, and evaluation of long-term and intermediate sector programs. There has been progress towards the mainstreaming of human rights within the national policy framework. The long-term development framework for Belize, Horizon 2030, declares that, quote, the state is respectful of people's human rights and citizens and visitors respect the rule of law and feel secure and safe, as part of the statement of stakeholders' vision for Belize. It should be noted that respect for the rule of law and for human rights is listed as among the foremost guiding principles for Belize's long-term development. The government of Belize is guided in the short term by its three-year medium-term strategy. And this also focuses on poverty alleviation and human rights. Persistent levels of poverty and widening income disparity continue to pose a serious challenge to human rights and to the development of human rights and the full expression of persons' dignities and freedoms. Nevertheless, the government of Belize is committed to eliminating poverty and has identified key priorities and launched a number of policy interventions to this end. The government of Belize recognizes that external debt constraints not only constrains national development progress, but also undermines the capacity to establish conditions for the realization of human rights. Our most honorable Prime Minister, in his 2011 to 2012 budget speech, stated that it is a factual recognition that our country does not have the ability to meet all its commercial obligations under the current superbond terms if it is to meet all its social obligations under the political, economic, and existential contract with its citizens. To put this in perspective, at the end of 2012, the outstanding public sector debt stood at Belize $2.37 billion, which is equivalent to 81% of GDP. And of this, the debt held in unsustainable commercial arrangements stood at $1.06 billion Belize dollars. The heavy debt service prompted the government of Belize to initiate a process of renegotiation of the commercial bond. And this was successful. And the purpose of this was to allow the government to have a greater focus on social protection, poverty reduction, citizen security, education, health, and physical infrastructure. The efforts of the state in promoting and protecting human rights in Belize have been bolstered by the advocacy work done by members of civil society. The greatest challenge with the implementation of sector plans that seek to advance human rights continues to be the lack of financial resources. Notwithstanding such limitations, human rights in Belize are being advanced in many respects, as demonstrated by the response of the very active advocacy interest groups on various subject matter. For example, the United Belize Advocacy Movement, UNIBAM, formed in 2006, represents lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender persons, and is challenging the constitutionality of the unnatural crime provision in Belize's criminal code. The Council of Churches and Belize Association of Evangelical Churches are interest groups opposed to the removal of the unnatural crime provision, who are also expressing their opinion. The newly formed Generation Zero is another example of a human rights organization formed by young people who are also expressing their issues and have voiced their opinion on issues related to HIV, stigma, and discrimination. The Maya Leaders Alliance is yet another example of an interest group. Belize has had the benefit of submitting our national report for the United Nations Human Rights Council's Universal Periodic Review in 2013, and that served to raise awareness and gave us an excellent opportunity to review our status concerning human rights. And now address our efforts to implement treaty obligations. Belize is committed to meeting its treaty and reporting obligations in respect of various human rights treaties to which it is a party, and has taken measures to implement those treaties with a view to promoting the enjoyment of human rights and fundamental freedoms for all. Nevertheless, as with small states, the reporting requirements arising from human rights and other treaties are onerous and continue to pose a challenge. Financial, technical, and human resource constraints have, despite the best efforts, impeded its ability to submit timely reports. This problem is compounded by the sheer number of different mechanisms requiring follow-up and reporting. Aside from the reporting challenges, the government of Belize remains committed to this and to its implementing of its treaty obligations. One positive step in this direction is that the Attorney General's Ministry and the Ministry of Foreign Affairs are currently updating and improving their treaties registry. An International Legal Affairs Department has been established within the Attorney General's Ministry to strengthen the government's support system, including providing opinions on human rights issues. I'll now address the issue of social protection. According to the recent Living Standards Measurement Survey, household poverty in Belize increased from 25% in 2002 to 33% in 2009. And the indigence rate increased from 10.5% to 15.8%. The all poor population in Belize is comprised of 136,640 persons, which constitutes a large portion of the population. A revised National Poverty Elimination Strategy and Action Plan outlines the measures to be undertaken towards eliminating poverty. Both the National Poverty Assessment and the 2010 census show that female-headed households are not poorer than male-headed households. The government of Belize has mainstreamed pro-poor policies in its national development framework. For example, its public sector investment program, valued at $591 million, reflects the strategic objective of poverty reduction. The PSIP consists of infrastructure, economic services, and social protection programs. The two key complementary pro-poor initiatives, Boost and the Food Pantry Program, coordinated by the Ministry of Human Development, Social Transformation, and Poverty Alleviation, have been successful in reaching the poor. Together, these programs provide assistance to approximately 17%, or 136,640, of the poor population, and are financed principally by the government of Belize at an approximate cost of Belize dollars, $7.5 million. There are plans to expand the number of beneficiary households. Boost was launched in 2010 as a national program with both urban and rural coverage. It is an amalgamation and upgrading of existing social assistance programs. The program's overarching goals are twofold: to provide immediate relief to poor families through small but steady cash transfers, and second, to reduce poverty in the long run through improvements in poor children's human capital potential. 3 years into implementation, Boost has more than tripled its beneficiaries, reaching 3,500 households, and 96% of beneficiaries are now integrated in the alternative financial system. The government-subsidized food pantry program, introduced in 2010, is targeted at working poor families in Belize, Cayo, and Toledo districts. It costs $5 per day for an adult to purchase 2,000 quality calories per day. Eligible beneficiaries are working families who earn less than $35 per week. Approximately 10,000 persons were directly benefiting from this scheme in the last financial year. To address specific interventions in key geographic areas such as in Belize City and Toledo, where the incidence of poverty is high, a project called Improving Children's Health and Nutrition in Poor Mayan Communities in Toledo is being implemented by the Ministry of Health. The project seeks to improve the health and nutrition of children in the Toledo district through an early childhood development approach focusing on prenatal care, nutrition monitoring in the critical window of opportunity, and school health interventions at the primary school level. There are 24,700 community residents in the Toledo district that benefit directly or indirectly from this program. Now address the issue of HIV/AIDS. The government of Belize is committed to the global goal of getting to zero, and the Ministry of Health has adopted, with some success, a progressive and inclusive approach to tackling the challenges posed by HIV. During the period 2009 to 2011, there was a decrease in the total number of new HIV infections. In 2012, there was an increase of 10%. However, in light of a recent survey done with the most at-risk populations, we now know that the greater incidence lies within one sector of society, and we are in a position to better target national efforts to contain and reduce the risks. The government of Belize continues to provide universal access to antiretroviral treatments to people living with HIV in line with its global commitment. With respect to treatment regimes, in 2012, the threshold for treatment eligibility for antiretroviral drugs was increased to CD4-500, consistent with international standards of treatment and the documented number of persons on antiretroviral therapy was 1,040. With the support of the Global Fund, the level of psychosocial support has been increased for persons living with HIV, including dietary support to help with the compliance of medication. The Global Fund supports 275 orphans and vulnerable children who are HIV positive or who are affected by HIV due to the infection of one parent. In addition, nutrition and hygiene supports are provided to persons living with HIV. There are 66 locations across the country that provide HIV testing in accordance with national standards, 54 in public and 12 in private care settings. The extension of HIV testing sites to the rural communities has improved coverage, resulting in an increase of the total number of HIV tests conducted countrywide by 4.3% in 2012. Since 2001, the government of Belize continues to implement the Prevention of Mother-to-Child Transmission Program to reduce the risk of HIV-infected pregnant mothers passing the virus to their newborns. This program has been integrated within the public health prenatal clinics countrywide to enhance its impact. In 2012, 93% of all pregnant women were tested for HIV, of which 95% received treatment to reduce the risk of transmission. As a result, of the 44 exposed babies, only 2 were positive. The Behavioral Seroprevalence Survey was conducted in 2012 to obtain information on the characteristic of the HIV epidemic and to improve and guide planning and policy development at the national level for the response to HIV. This survey confirmed that the HIV epidemic is concentrated in the men who have sex with men group at 14%, while the prevalence of HIV among female commercial sex workers was 1%. health officials fully recognize the priority must now be concentrated on men. The National AIDS Commission is spearheading a comprehensive legal exercise to ensure consistency of domestic legislation with the national HIV policy. The legal review will make specific recommendations to modify those sections of the law that are discriminatory and introduce new laws addressing the protection of the rights of persons living with HIV. The National AIDS Commission has identified reducing stigma as one of the priority areas for its education and prevention campaigns. This approach is necessary given the findings of the survey that discrimination and violence against persons with HIV is prevalent and is directly tied to their HIV status. In October 12, a conference on stigma and discrimination was held to create awareness among the general public and professionals to the extent of the problem. At a prevention summit held in April 2013, the National AIDS Commission committed to redefine prevention initiatives. Finally, I will address the issue of refugees. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees local implementing partner, Help for Progress, who is present today, assists the Immigration Department to implement the standard operating procedure that identifies asylum seekers and recognizes refugees in need of protection. Once processed, the government of Belize provides formally identified asylum seekers with free permits to remain in Belize until refugee status determination is completed, and they may seek employment if they are able to meet the financial requirements. Refugees, asylum seekers, and their families are allowed subsidized primary health care. Children aged 6 to 14 have access to subsidized primary school education. Children of asylum seekers who are born in Belize are provided with Belizean citizenship with all its rights and responsibilities. The state assumes protection for the asylum seekers, refugees, and their families. At present, Belize has an asylum population of 72 persons, of which 55% are women and girls and 45% are between the ages of 4 and 65 years. Most refugees and asylum seekers live dispersed in rural and urban areas. Many have been granted residency as a durable solution. An eligibility committee for refugee status determination has been named and has not yet met to review pending applications. The United Nations High Commissioner for Refugees has sponsored several immigration officers, five of which just completed a course in Virginia, to be trained in refugee law and adjudicating asylum cases. These are our submissions, and we remain available to the Commission for further questions.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ramsey. We are joined now by the representatives for the Maya Leaders Alliance, and I crave the indulgence of the state to give them an opportunity to make their presentation. Ms. Ka, the floor is yours. And if you could introduce yourself first, in view of the circumstances, we will have less time, but we welcome hearing from you.
Thank you kindly, and I want to say thank you for accommodating. I apologize for being a little late. Good morning, distinguished commissioners and delegates from the government of Belize. My name is Christina Cook. I represent the Maya Leaders Alliance, an umbrella organization which represents the rights of the Maya villages in the Toledo district of Belize. This alliance is composed of leaders from a variety of Maya organizations, including the Toledo Alcaldes Association, an association of traditional elected leaders of all the Maya villages in the Toledo district. I'm here today to provide information on the human rights situation in Belize as it relates to the Maya indigenous people of the Toledo district, and to request the Commission's assistance in urging the government to enter into good faith consultations with the Maya people through appropriate procedures that conform to international standards and Maya customary law, and in order to develop effective mechanisms to secure our rights, including in relation to oil development activities occurring on Maya traditional lands. Just to give a brief background, to remind the Commission in its final report number 4004 of October 12, 2004, Maya indigenous communities of Toledo District of Belize, it found, among other things, that the state of Belize had violated the right to property as enshrined in the American Declaration by not recognizing our communal property rights to ancestral lands and territories, and by granting oil concessions without our free, prior, and informed consent. The Commission recommended that Belize delimit, demarcate, and title Maya lands, and to abstain until then from any acts that might affect our territory. By way of background, the Supreme Court of Belize issued two decisions in 2007 and 2010 that recognized and protected Maya customary land rights and enjoined the government from interfering with the use and enjoyment of Maya lands in the absence of our consent. The decisions affirmed the findings of the Commission in its final report of 2004 and applied for the very first time any domestic court the United Nations Declaration on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples. The government appealed the 2010 Supreme Court decision, and the Court of Appeals issued its decision in 2013. It affirmed Maya land rights generally in accordance with the lower court ruling, but lifted the injunction against interference with Maya lands. This judgment has been further appealed to the highest court in Belize judicial system, the Caribbean Court of Justice, which sits in Trinidad and Tobago. The hearing is expected to occur at the end of this year or early 2015. In the meantime, the government of Belize has allowed oil exploration activities to continue. On April 20th, 2013, it granted permission to an American transnational, U.S. Capital Energy Limited, to explore for oil within Sarstoun-Timash National Park. The Sarstoun-Timash Institute for Indigenous Management, SATIM, an NGO working with Maya villages adjacent to the national park where the drill site is located, went to court to challenge the permits. On April 3, 2014, the Supreme Court of Belize once again found in favor of the Maya indigenous community's right to protection of our lands and resources and ordered the government to seek and obtain our free, prior, and informed consent before proceeding with further oil exploration activities. The court responded to the state's insistence that the Mayas have no customary rights to our lands by stating, and I quote, "That ship has already sailed, and it is therefore in the best interest of all parties concerned to come together and put in place measures that will ensure that those rights are respected and enforced." A copy of the judgment has been submitted with this presentation. In a subsequent injunction filed by SATIM, heard on June 2014, the court ordered the government to enter into mediation with the affected communities. We have had a lot of engagements with international mechanisms as well. The situation of the Maya indigenous people has been addressed by a number of United Nations human rights bodies and mechanisms in response to information filed by the Maya Leaders Alliance. The Committee on the Elimination of Racial Discrimination, CERD, expressed its concerns regarding the situation under its urgent action and early warning procedures in letters from 2007, 2008, and 2012. Additionally, in its 2013 concluding observations on Belize, issued in the absence of a report, the committee urged the government of Belize to stop granting leases and oil concessions without obtaining the free, prior, informed consent of the Maya people, in full compliance with the ruling of the Supreme Court and the recommendations of the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights. The Human Rights Committee in 2013 concluded that the state party should desist from issuing new concessions for logging, parceling for private leasing, oil drilling, seismic surveys, and our road infrastructure projects in Mayan territories without the free prior informed consent of the relevant Mayan communities. In the most recent Universal Periodic Review of Belize, Spain recommended that Belize monitor continuously the extractive activities of oil companies in Mayan territory, which must always respect human rights. The recommendation was accepted by Belize, but that acceptance has not been reflected in the actions of the government towards the Maya people. The Maya Leaders Alliance have been communicating with the United Nations Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights through its regional office for Central America. The OHCHR staff is following the situation closely. The coordinator is involved, and we hope that Belize will welcome the UN involvement in discussions between the government and the Mayas. The current situation, the Maya Leaders Alliance is focused on the implementation and enforcement of the Maya rights that have been repeatedly recognized and affirmed by the courts of Belize and by international institutions. The MLA, in accordance with the desire of the Maya people, is developing comprehensive programs to empower Maya communities by strengthening our governance capacity, especially in relation to land management, and in developing initiatives for sustainable development and conservation within the traditional lands that have been confirmed as belonging to Maya people. Our experience has proven across the globe, it shows that without such governance capacity and planning, it is difficult, if not impossible, for indigenous peoples to effectively exercise rights over lands and resources in the face of continual pressures by outsiders to access our resources. And finally, I want to conclude the request for assistance by the Commission, given the government's failure thus far to faithfully comply with 5 domestic court orders, continued international attention is vital to impress the seriousness of the situation on the government of Belize. We urge the Commission to communicate with the government of Belize and urge it to engage in good faith consultations with the Maya people through appropriate procedures that conform to the relevant international standards, decisions of international human rights institutions, and Maya customary law in order to develop effective mechanisms to secure our rights, and including in relation to oil development activities occurring on Maya traditional lands. Second, we ask the Commission to issue a press release, a communication to Belize, or any other measures it sees fit to urge the government to respect the domestic court decisions and abide by international law, including the recommendation of the Commission. And finally, we urge the Commission to schedule a site visit by the Rapporteur on the Rights of Indigenous People, Commissioner Rosemarie Bell Antoine, to meet with the government of Belize, U.S. Capital Energy executives, and the Maya leaders in southern Belize. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Cock, and thank you for the accommodation in relation to the time. I wanted to invite my colleagues to offer some observations, and we will have an opportunity for both the petitioners and the state to respond, including to the last presentation by the petitioners. Can I ask if the country rapporteur wishes to say a word, Commissioner Rosa Maria Ortiz?
Gracias, Presidenta. Voy a hablar en español. Agradezco en primer lugar al Gobierno de México que nos permite tener esta audiencia hoy aquí con el Gobierno de Ilustre Estado de Belice y los peticionarios. Agradezco mucho a los peticionarios, a las peticionarias por acercar a la Comisión situaciones que preocupan en Belice en materia de derechos humanos y lo mismo al Estado de Belice por ponernos al día en la manera en que están encarando en esta joven nación de pocos años desde su independencia y que sin embargo ha demostrado su interés en un crecimiento y en un desarrollo respetuoso de los derechos humanos. Hemos escuchado del rol pionero de Belice en el sistema Centroamericano de Derechos Humanos, la SICA, y estamos seguros de que tuve oportunidad de visitar Belice hace unos años y pude ver que hay un diálogo accesible entre sociedad civil y Estado, por lo menos hace unos años era así, y también vemos en la información que recibimos de la sociedad civil un respeto hacia las autoridades y a lo que las autoridades están proponiendo. Sin embargo, estamos aquí para ver aquellos aspectos que todavía precisan una atención especial del gobierno de Belice. Identificamos las grandes preocupaciones en materia del derecho a la propiedad de las tierras indígenas y todo lo que representa para los pueblos indígenas hacerse cargo de su cultura en una tierra específica vinculada con su historia. Estamos en una región que tiene muchísimos problemas de desplazamientos de poblaciones. Vemos los problemas de migración que en este momento acucian sobre todo a la región de Centroamérica, México y Estados Unidos. Y
US, we are certain that if we address all these problems linked to the lands of indigenous peoples as well as with the exploitation of natural resources is a way to address the concerns stated by the government for the development of its people and of their peoples, because there is a great cultural diversity, and this is also a way to ensure human rights. We are very concerned about criminalized treatment of migrants. We have listened very carefully all your presentations. We are very concerned about the criminalization that leads you to be arrested together with people that have already been convicted, and all the effects that these producers. And migration is a right. We have rapporteurs of the different areas that will be working on this. As well as what other people decide. You have just explained that you are in this process, but in the Inter-American Commission, we want to be very close to you and work to solve these difficulties that are still existing in Belize. As a rapporteur of the children's right, I have to tell you what is happening with migrant children, especially children who migrate by themselves, and what is happening in Belize. The question is for both parties. Is there a problem of children that migrate by themselves looking to go to the north, and which are the bilateral agreements between Belize and the other countries of the region? Which are the benefits and which are the difficulties that you are still experiencing in complying, in fulfilling these bilateral agreements that we know they are in place? Le voy a pedir al relator de pueblos indígenas y después al relator para que nos dé sus observaciones.
Good morning, everyone. I would also like to thank the Honorable State and the petitioners for coming all the way to Mexico to present this hearing. We're very much appreciative of the information from both sides. I thought that the petitioners raised some very specific questions, of course, on different areas, so I'm going to address the areas separately. And I would have liked to have heard from the state some responses which were more directly attributed to the questions that were asked. You gave a good overview of human rights in Belize, and I agree with you that in the Caribbean, coming from the Caribbean myself, we do have economic challenges, but of course fundamental human rights are not always linked to economic circumstances, and indeed, human rights must go beyond dollars and cents. So there were some specific questions, I think, that the petitioners raised, which we still would need answers from. Now, I don't know if you had the opportunity before to see what the petitioners were going to be raising, I don't know. But I wanted to let you know that we can still entertain your responses in writing to the specific questions that were raised by the petitioners, and I, for one, would like to see it. In relation to migrant workers, the petitioners mentioned that those persons were being deprived of their right to associate. It's not clear to me that the law specifically excludes migrant workers from the right to associate. So my question is it really a question of how the law is enforced or implemented or not enforced, as the case may be? Or it may boil down to the question of who is an employee. So it may be a question of the concept of an employee or worker. To my mind, that would not be defined in such a way as to specifically exclude a worker. So I would want to see some more detailed information as to why you believe that there's a legal paradigm that in Belize that actually would exclude migrant workers. And I'm not here talking about undocumented workers, I'm talking about documented migrant workers, legal ones, in other words. You did explain fear, etc. I understand that. But if you're talking about human rights and the obligations of the state, are we saying that the laws themselves preclude that? This is not clear to me that this is the reality in Belize. So we would want some more information as opposed to enforcement. And I also think that we need to make a distinction between the regime of migrant workers who are there legally in the country, who generally in CARICOM and in Belize would generally be entitled to enjoy whatever labor rights exist, and undocumented workers who may be in a different situation. Again, on that topic, in terms of migrant workers, HIV was mentioned. Now, the state indicated, yes, in Belize, there's universal access to treatment and so. That may well be so, and I am aware of some of the work that Belize has done, some of the good work that Belize has done. But again, we were not given specific information as whether migrants in Belize, migrant workers and those who don't work, are able to access this HIV treatment. Right now in CARICOM, there's a move, there's a very strong move to ensure that even undocumented migrants have access to HIV treatment and services. And that is a right in a loose sense, in terms of migration policy, migration rights policy, but also it's a public health rationale, that if you don't ensure that those persons have access, then you can, HIV is more easily spread. So there's a pragmatic rationale to that. So I would like to know whether Belize has even considered this issue. Is there a policy, when you talk about universal access, unless you specifically direct your attention to this very grave problem, especially in Belize where you have so many migrants, then you're not going to reach those persons. And is it the case that you're even, how do you even know in your statistics whether these persons are being reached by the law and by the treatment and by the health services? Those are specific issues that have to do with HIV, and I think we need answers in relation to it. I think it's, in terms of migrants and HIV and all of that, we're talking about civil and political rights on the one hand, because we are saying we want to have non-discrimination, but we're also talking about economic, social, and cultural rights, the right to health, which is an important issue arising. I do think Belize has to be congratulated for their human trafficking in persons laws and policies, which was also mentioned by the petitioners. Belize was one of the first countries to introduce it. But again, I got no information as to what happens in terms of enforcing the law. So you have this wonderful law, you have a policy, but when you identify victims of trafficking in persons, what happens then? Are these persons treated like undocumented migrants? Are they detained in the same prison cells that the petitioner spoke about, because there's an obligation on the host state to ensure a safe route for victims of trafficking. So that would be a gray area that I'd be very concerned about, because these are persons who are indeed migrants. They're not refugees and asylum seekers. What happens there in terms of migration? And especially children and women, who are often the victims of trafficking. And just a couple other points I wanted to make on the LGBTI, but I think I'll leave that for my president, who is the authority on that. Just to say generally that Belize may have good policies on asylum and refugees, which you did tell us about, but again, the gray area is undocumented migrants and these issues. And finally, but not least, the issue of indigenous peoples. I just wanted to say that we are fully on board, the Commission, about the issues in relation to Belize and the few countries in the CARICOM region that have substantial indigenous populations. We see a clear trend in the region, actually, about violations of rights to consultation and issues in relation to extractive industries and natural resources. And I wanted to tell you that the Commission has commissioned a report. So we are launching a report on that very issue to do with exploitation of natural resources. So I suspect we will be coming to Belize, but we have also agreed to have some training for CARICOM states, for both the state and NGOs. In those countries in CARICOM where we feel they need to strengthen those human rights. So thank you for bringing that attention again, but we are indeed working on it.
Can I also invite the second vice president and rapporteur for migrants, Felipe Gonzalez.
Muy buenos días a todos y a todas.
Everyone, señor Felipe González,
Estado de Belice y por las peticionarias y el peticionario. Y quería hacer algunas observaciones y preguntas en relación
precisamente con el First of all, regarding the criminalization of irregular migration. These were some issues addressed by the petitioners. This is an issue that the Commission has been addressing in its reports in different countries, and we have continuously emphasized the need to remove criminalization on irregular migration. I would like to know whether there are some initiatives, and I would like to ask the Honorable State of Belize whether you have been working on any ways to remove criminalization on irregular migration. Because this is not a crime. And the second issue that the Commissioner Antoine has already mentioned is regarding the rights of migrant workers. Generally speaking, any person has right, as stated by the Commission and in the Protocol of San Salvador about the cultural and working rights. And in the case of the resources of workers, the Inter-American Court, in its 18th resolution, it has been mentioned that every workers, even though they are undocumented, they have rights. I don't know if it has been well understood. And I have the same doubt whether this is something that was stated by the law or this is just a set of practices. I think that it is the second option what is prevailing. I would like to know what are the initiatives that will be adopted uh, regarding migrant workers and their rights. And the next item, the next issue has to do with LGBT persons and workers. This is of utmost interest for the Inter-American Commission, and according to what it has been already mentioned here, we are also talking about the sodomy law in Belize about homosexual communities. Well, we were just expecting the decision of by the Supreme Court of the country. There are different viewpoints by different groups in Belize. Now, it is important to mention that regarding international commitments by the different states, this is not only belongs to executive powers, but to other sectors of the state. Well, it will be very important to reach an agreement by the states and intended to make effective the rights of the LGBT community in Belize, as well as of migrant communities. And I would also like to mention the advances regarding murder of people from the LGBTI community. Thank you very much, Commissioner Gonzalez.
I'd like the minister to respond. I did want the state to also, if they had information, know, but it may well be easier to send it to us to tell us about compliance with the decisions relating to the Maya Leaders Alliance, particularly the decision of the Commission and of the domestic courts, the Supreme Court and the Court of Appeal, and also what processes are underway to enter into negotiations with the Mayan community in Toledo to realize the rights which have been established both in international law and under the Constitution. I'm going to give the petitioners about 5 minutes between you all and invite you to respond to some of the questions. I'll say the same thing I did before, that there's some information which you may prefer to present to us afterwards in view of the time constraints. The floor is yours.
Good morning once more. I'll be dealing with it as per the commissioners that raised different issues. In the case of Rosa Maria Ortiz, the treatment of illegal immigration status to the level of criminalization, unfortunately this is embedded in law in Belize. And it will take significant reform of the migratory laws that we can overcome this and therefore guarantee the fundamental rights of those migrants who are, some of them, passing through Belize. Yes, some of them are unaccompanied minors. We know of 2 cases of unaccompanied minors being placed in prison, unfortunately, because that's the law. With respect to the human trafficking victims, we must praise the government for giving them fair and just treatment, and those are not criminalized. The unaccompanied minors are generally treated quite differently. The Department of Human Services steps in and see how they best can help those people under the human trafficking victims. We know of a couple of cases as well where they have provided shelter for some of these victims with families, because they have a register of families of people who want to assist these victims, and we must commend them for that. Likewise, to address Rosemary's concern with the right of association and collective bargaining, yes, it is enshrined in our constitution that we have the right to associate. And yes, it is enshrined in a recent amendment to the Labor Act in May of 2011 that the right to collective bargaining as per the, to reflect the national reality in accordance with the ILO convention. However, on the ground, there are serious problems on the ground. It's basically in the implementation of such laws. In regards also to the LGBTI population, the use of the test to discriminate against them is what really we're getting at. People tend to, well, employers tend to not hire if they know that the person is HIV positive. In regards to, again, I guess, Felipe Gonzalez's issue on the illegal migration status, I hope it was covered under the response to Rosa Maria. And if there's any other question, I would deal with it. No, if not, I would pass over the mic to the Maya Leader Alliance.
Thank you. I don't believe there was a specific question to the Maya Leaders Alliance, so I'll make a very brief comment. I just wanted to say, I'm very grateful and we are certainly encouraged that the Commission has commissioned a report to address the issues that we've raised, particularly with respect to free prior informed consent and extraction of resources. We're hopeful that the state will accept the much needed training as a part of CARICOM. And certainly the Maya leaders remain hopeful that the government of Belize will take advantage of the calls for good faith negotiations. We are prepared to meet with the government to discuss all outstanding issues affecting our lands and our communities. Thank you.
Can I invite the representatives of the state to respond, again indicating that we have the opportunity to receive in writing additional observations? The floor is yours. Can we turn on the mic for the state, please?
Testing. Yeah. All right, Belize would first like to thank the commission, or the members of the commission that offer commendations and recognize our efforts towards securing human rights for all persons within our jurisdiction. We're also grateful for the issues that were raised and the questions that were asked, because they allow us to assess our position and to take necessary steps in the interests of all. We have recorded the specific questions raised by Commissioners Ortiz, Antoine, Gonzalez, and Madam President. And there are three primary issues that have come to the fore. First is the issue of migration. And we are keenly interested in this issue, and it is an issue that both the Immigration Department and relevant ministry have been looking into. Unfortunately, I did not have the opportunity to review the specific questions that were raised today prior to making the presentation. But I hope that some of the statistics that were mentioned concerning the number of migrants into Belize would have been useful for the Commission to understand the full extent of the situation and the need for additional resources. In that regard, I'd also like to reiterate that all asylum seekers and persons who are given refugee status in particular are permitted to get subsidized primary health care and also subsidized primary school education. With regard to the other issues raised concerning freedom of association, we reiterate that the law does provide for freedom of association for all. And if there are specific instances, then it is something that we can undertake to look into further. But I'm not in a position to comment specifically on that at this time. With regard to human trafficking, both the police and the Ministry of Human Development remain committed to combating this problem. And I'd like to thank the member of civil society for recognizing the efforts of the government of Belize in this regard. The second issue that was raised concerns LGBT. And
on again. Could we again check the mic? Or could we offer them this one?
Bueno. Yes, concerning LGBT rights, I'd like to mention that the government of Belize is a state that remains committed to respecting the fundamental human rights of all persons within its jurisdiction. And this general principle was enunciated by Most Honorable Prime Minister in his 2013 Independence Day speech, when he stated, and I will quote, "Recently, however, a most unsettling phenomenon has arisen. A version of the culture wars has come to our country, and it is souring the harmony and disrupting the rhythm of Belizean life. The golden knot that ties us all together is in danger of coming loose. Now, I do not wish to give offense to anyone on Independence Day. So what I say next is spoken not in anger or even in sorrow, but merely by way of exhortation. The diversity that we have hymned for so long must not now prove to be an empty trough, so much PR fluff. It must pass this latest test. In particular, we cannot afford for government and the churches to be at odds. The filigree chain that links the two is a proud part of the national ornamentation, and it cannot be allowed to break. Government will therefore fully respect the right of the churches to propagate their understanding of morality or immorality of homosexuality. But what government cannot do is shirk its duty to ensure that all citizens, without exception, enjoy the full protection of the law. After all, the Belizean constitution that affirms the supremacy of God also affirms fundamental rights and the dignity of the individual human being. That same constitution further declares that all persons are equal before the law and entitled to non-discrimination, to freedom from interference with their privacy, and to freedom from unlawful attacks on their honor and reputation. There is, I submit, no logical inconsistency between these two different tenets of our Constitution, and government, the churches, and the Belizean polity must find a way to uphold all the principles of our foundation document." Now, two issues were raised which remain sub judice, meaning that they are still before the courts, and therefore the Belizean government cannot specifically comment on these issues. Those issues are Section 53 of the Criminal Code, which deals with the sodomy law, and also the Immigration Act. Third issue mentioned is with regard to indigenous persons. Now, Belize would like to reiterate again that it is committed to respecting and promoting indigenous rights within the confines of the law. Both the culture and rights of indigenous people are deeply embedded in Belizean society, from the names, the name of the capital, the design of government buildings, and so on. And the government remains committed to the 10-point agreement signed by the parties on October 12, 2000. Now, the commission will note, as mentioned by the representative from civil society, that the Courts of Appeal in 2013 recognized that the Mayans had communal land rights, but that the government has the right to exploit the resources on the land. Both parties have appealed the decision of the court, and it remains sub judice. And Belize will be guided by the court's determination on this issue and is unable to comment further. We thank you for the opportunity.
Many thanks to both the representatives of the state and to civil society. You have heard from the commission its commitment to continuing to follow up on all of the issues that have been raised by the petitioners. We welcome the response of the state, but we look forward to receiving some additional information. There's also a golden opportunity for the state of Belize to ratify the American Convention on Human Rights, to become fully engaged in the Inter-American system. And as we are here in a special session in Mexico City, we welcome the opportunity to see more advances in the support for the Inter-American system by Belize and other countries in the region. Thank you very much. We will begin the next hearing in about 5 minutes. Thank you both.